We want large numbers of men in Great Britain who are British subjects between the ages of 17 and 65. 17 and 65. To come forward now and offer their service in order to make assurance doubly sure. The name of the new force, which is now to be raised, will be the Local Defence Volunteers.
Well, the government had not shown much enthusiasm for a volunteer force in the past, old chaps. They did not want to allow ordinary citizens to take matters into their own hands, of course, and out of the authority of the army and police. However, along the coast of England, militias were starting to form, which led them to rethink their policy. On the 14th of May 1940, Secretary of State for the War, Anthony Eden, had foreseen the imminent danger and made an urgent broadcast on the wireless, you see.
On the 23rd of August 1940, Winston Churchill changed the name of the Local Defence Volunteers to the Home Guard. Churchill was a vocal supporter of the Home Guard, and it was he who insisted that its name was changed. In a BBC broadcast on the wireless on the 14th of July 1940, Churchill said of the Home Guard, "These officers and men, a large proportion of whom had been through the last war, have the strongest desire to attack and come to close quarters with the enemy, wherever he may appear. Should the invader come to Britain, there will be no placid lying down of the people in submission before him, as we have seen, alas, in other countries. We shall defend every village, every town, and every city." What was at first a ragtag militia, with scarce and often make-do uniforms and weaponry, evolved into a well-equipped and well-trained army.
But then as time marched on, so the Home Guard progressed. Instead of denim overalls, battle dress for uniform. Instead of shotguns, new weapons. It grew into a great force of nearly 2 million men trained in modern infantry duties and tactics with a proper pride in its own efficiency. Only history will be able to tell the full story of the part taken by the Home Guard in saving Britain from invasion during the first stage of its career.
It'll fight in France. It will fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. we shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender, and if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it were subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
Well, I say, old chaps, fancy that. The stove's buggered. No, it's not really. We lost one of the the little potholders in the bushes, so I had to go scourging around there for a moment. But never mind, these things are said to try us, and now the return pressure valve is clearly needs some overhaul, so I've made shift with a rubber band, make do amends and all that. So anyway, let's get on and cook some corned beef fritters. Well, old chaps, the first thing we need, of course, is 2 ounces of self-raising or plain flour. And adding to that a pinch of salt. So I've already measured up the flour. As you say, any flour is fine, self-raising or plain. There you go. In she goes. So we're going to go ahead and add in an egg yolk, or you can use a reconstituted egg, of course, there is a war on. Add that in. And then now we want to go in, add in half a gill. Now, that's in old money, but in new money, that's about 17 millilitres of milk. Okay, I've already pretty much measured this out in here, okay. And then, old chaps, I've just got some garden herbs here. Got some oregano, or as our American allies like to say, oregano. Just get those in there, they're fresh out the garden. Bit of rosemary. Okay, there's that. So next we're going to go ahead and add in some grated onion, okay. I grated before I left, so carrying a grater, obviously before I left jumping out the aircraft. We're going in with the corned beef. You can't have corned beef fritters without corned beef now, can you, old chaps? Absolutely not. So we want about 6 ounces of corned beef. Okay, I'm going to go with beefy goodness out. Right. You want to mix that up and get that into there. Oh, lost a bit, excuse fingers. 2 second roll. And I'm going to put a little bit in for extra, okay? Alright. Now we've got a lovely mix. And now just take that and work it to a paste, okay? And work it round to a paste, making sure everything's mixed up. It's a bit like making pancakes, really. It's the same principle. Don't worry, it's a bit of a slurry. No worry, slurry. Alright, old chaps, just get it to a nice consistency. A bit like porridge, okay? Or you can hear the hurlock going in the background. Get it to a nice slurry like that. Alright. And then, old chaps, let it rest for a couple of minutes while you get the hot pan on, okay? We're going to cook this in beef dripping, just like your nan would have done in 1940. Alright, old chaps? So, you would have seen David Fryers use one of these, old chaps. This is one of David's bags. And this is one of my pans, okay? So, this is what we're going to use on the home front today. 2 wing nuts, 2 little split washers, okay. Flip that round. and it just goes back on itself. Okay, and split washers, don't lose them. Steak detective. Like that. These pans are by the Netherton Foundry. I've used them for like 3 years. And so what I like about these is they can be stowed quickly and easily for stealth camping, okay? Behind enemy lines or on the home front.
There you go.
So chaps, we're just going to get a generous amount of lard into here, okay? That's what your nan would have cooked with back in 1940. They would have saved up all their bacon fat. Drip in, we use what they had. Okay, let's just, we'll melt that down. So remember what I said about the consistency, old chaps. You want it a bit like porridge, okay? Very important. There's my modification there on the Herlock. I'm going to have to get that checked out, old chaps. But she's doing the trick, you know. It's all about make, mend and do, isn't it? There's our dripping just melting down. And it's an absolutely stunning evening. I'm looking out over the stop line in the position of the home guard where they would have been, standing on top of a World War II pillbox in the Surrey Hills. There she goes, she's steaming, she's good. Now, so just make sure that dripping's nice and even in the pan, okay? Now just go ahead and take a generous portion of that. And just nurse them around, okay? There you go. It's a bit like making a pancake. Now obviously as they cook, you'll see the consistency change. I tell you what, them home guard, they couldn't build a straight pillbox. As I said, just nurse it while it cooks. Let's go for a second over there, like so. We'll have to separate them a bit. We're fighting, do we? Chaps. So, and then old chaps, we'll see they start to get a bit more rigid, and then you can eventually turn them, all right? They go that golden brown colour, looking more like a fritter now. Well, old chaps, it's lovely here. It's the evening, it's June. And it's just so quiet. All we can hear is the roaring of the Herlock, which is what the home guard would have used back here in 1940 onwards. And, you know, there's something to be said about just getting back and just being in a place where history is just absolutely rife. Anyway, old chaps, I'm going to eat my corporate fritters. I'll see you shortly. It's absolutely stunning here. It's a summer's evening. It's not a cloud in the sky. It's getting dusk. And it's nearly time for tea. It's corned beef fritters, you know, just like your nan made in 1940. Cheers, old chaps. So there you go, old chaps. That's the colour you want them. Just give them a flip. Well, old chap, there's our corned beef fritters. Now, they're not much to look at, but I assure you, they're blooming delicious. And I've got a little something here that's going to make them even better. Delicious. As I said, they don't look much, but I can assure you they're fantastic. Crunchy on the outside, soft in the inside, just like a good steak. Absolutely delicious. You taste the herbs in there as well, and it's all made even better with a liberation sauce. Well, I say, old chaps, thanks awfully for tuning in. It's getting dark now, but not to worry. We got the Home Guard here. There's a Home Guard in all of us, don't you know? See you soon. Tally-ho.